chase away as wounds which mar the chosen one, bring many sons to glory. Behold the man upon a cross, my sin upon his shoulders.
Tonight's Good Friday Tenebrae service. The word Tenebrae comes from the Latin for darkness. And every single one of us, if we know anything about this day, we know what darkness has to do with the day we remember the suffering and the death of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. So this service intentionally is meant to be for the mind, the spirit, the soul, and the senses. The words we will hear from Scripture and the meditations based upon those words are meant to resonate in our minds and prick our hearts. What we see as the room becomes darker with every passing meditation until we are left with nothing but the Christ candle to illuminate this very space. And even this 28 penny nail that you may have received on your way in, I encourage you, hold that in your hands throughout all that tonight entails. Feel the hardness, the coldness, the sharpness, all meant to take us to Golgotha that night. So now as we begin, I want to encourage you. There will be times of singing, there will be times of meditation and responsive praying and reading, and of course the screens will provide what we need to share in together. There also will be times of silence that may feel even awkward at first or make you feel uncertain, and that's okay. That's what they're meant to do. This is a time where we worship, we meditate, and we know, you all know like I do, Sunday is coming, right? But we miss something. We miss something when we fly through Good Friday too quickly, when we do not stop and humble ourselves at the foot of the cross, remembering why Christ gave his life for us. And that's why we are here tonight. And so let us begin. The Lord be with you and also with you. We gather here to worship God. We gather to remember how Jesus suffered and died for us and to thank God for his love and his mercy. A reading from the book of Isaiah, chapter 53, verses 1 through 3. Hear the word. Who has believed our message? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? He grew up before God like a tender shoot and like a root out of dry ground. He had no beauty or majesty to attract us to him, nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and familiar with suffering. Like one from whom men hide their faces, he was despised, and we esteemed him not. Let us pray. Merciful God, as we remember how your Son Jesus bore our sins in his body on the cross, how seven times he spoke, seven words of love, we ask you to bless our hearing. Father, as we recall how all 3 hours his silence cried for mercy on the souls of all, we ask you to help us to understand the mystery of your love and to make us into a people who are ever more worthy of it. Amen.
To die on Calvary. A reading from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 23, verses 33 and 34. When they came to the place called the Skull, they nailed Jesus to the cross there, and the two criminals, one on his right and one on his left. Jesus said, "Forgive them, Father. They do not know what they are doing." They do not know what they are doing. They do not know. They who killed Jesus, who are they? It is so easy to name others, to blame others. The Romans, the crowd, Pilate, Herod, Caiaphas, they all played their part and conspired against Jesus, or simply followed orders to maintain the peace, to keep Jesus' kingdom from infringing on theirs. And yet, where are we when Jesus' kingdom infringes on ours? On our peace and our order, on our prosperity and our security. Where are we when the victims of our peace cry for justice? When those disenfranchised and oppressed by our systems call for compassion? When the hungry and the lonely beg us to share our prosperity, our security, our power? Where are we when Christ is crucified among us? Surely he should have raged at the sinners who nailed him to the tree. Surely he should have raged at us for the evil we do. The evil we both do knowing and unknowing, both in the things done and left undone. Yet compassion is in those first words he utters. It was compassion that called him into being in his mother's womb, compassion that compelled him to the cross. Compassion that echoes through the centuries to all who participate in the killing of Christ. Compassion that cries out from the cross, interceding for us. Father, forgive them. They do not know what they are doing.
Lord Jesus, you gave your life for us. You suffered and died that we might be made whole.
Vast as the ocean, Reading from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 23, verses 39 through 43. One of the criminals hanging there threw insults at him. "Aren't you the Messiah? Save yourself and us." The other one, however, rebuked him, saying, "Don't you fear God? Here we are all under the same sentence. Ours, however, is only right, for we are getting what we deserve for what we did. But he has done no wrong." And he said to Jesus, "Remember me, Jesus, when you come as king." Jesus said to him, "I tell you this, today you will be in paradise with me." How much are we like the first thief, full of anger because we are not rescued from our sin, full of hate because we suffer from the sins of others? How much do we want God to snap his fingers and make right what we have made wrong, what we have allowed others to make wrong? How easy is it to cry, "Save us," and to rail against God when there is no magic cure, no miraculous recovery, no legions of angels to remove us from the pain? How easy is it to scorn the Messiah, to mock the goodness of the world, and condemn the light of the world, because we are unwilling to face what we have done? Yet there is goodness. There is a cure for sin, a cure that does not promise magical solutions, but promises that the pain of sin is not the end. That when the suffering is over, the final word is not torture and defeat, but life. Life springing out of the ashes, life offered and received even in final breaths, life transformed and fulfilled in paradise. To the compassionate thief, to the one who could still recognize goodness even in the midst of death, to the one who knew he could never earn the love of a Savior, to the one who could admit his wrong but still offer a hope-filled prayer, the promise of life is given. Today, you will be in paradise with me.
Lord Jesus, you gave your life for us. You suffered and died that we might be made whole.
So
A reading from the Gospel of John, chapter 19, verses 25 through 27. Standing close to Jesus' cross were his mother's sister Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. Jesus saw his mother and the disciple he loved standing there. So he said to his mother, "Woman, here is your son." Then he said to the disciple, "Here is your mother." And from that time, the disciple took her to live in his home. Who can grasp the grief? The grief of Mary watching her son suffer. The grief of watching him die. And who can grasp the grief of the son who must see his mother mourn? What gift can a man give his mother? What can he offer her when he's gone? How can he help her? Hold her, comfort her, honor her. Woman, here is your son. Here is one I love to love you and for you to love. One who knows me. One who is my brother and can speak of me. One to hold you, comfort you, honor you. One who shares your grief. And then to the disciple, Jesus says, "Here is your mother. Here is the one I love, to love you and for you to love. The one who knows me, the one who held me, fed me, taught me, the one who wiped away my tears, and now shares your grief. Women, behold your children. Children, behold your mothers."
Lord Jesus, you gave your life for us. You suffered and died that we might be made whole.
Were you there tremble, tremble, tremble. Were you there when they crucified my Lord? Were you there when they nailed him to the tree? Were you there when they nailed him to a tree?
A reading from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 15, verses 33 and 34. And when the sixth hour had come, there was darkness over the whole land until the ninth hour. And at the ninth hour, Jesus cried with a loud voice, "Eloi! Eloi, lama sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" Of all the agony of that torturous day, the lacerations of the scourging, the chafing of the thorns around his head, the convulsions of his tormented, dehydrated body as it hung in the heat all day. Nothing reaches the depth of this anguished cry of desolation. My God. My God, why have you forsaken me? Jesus, who found his purpose and strength as the incarnate Son, who was sustained by the immediacy of his relationship with the Father, who endured all by the tangible power of the Holy Spirit always at work within him, found himself totally alone on that cross. Jesus, who was both fully God and fully man, found himself utterly, absolutely
despairingly cut off from all that gives life and breath. Cut off from all that gives purpose and hope. Cut off from the very source of his being. Cut off even from himself. Plumbing the depths of the human condition to walk in the place of the utter absence of God in the place of sinners, in the place of those who reject God. My God, why have you forsaken me? And it is in these words we find the central mystery of the crucifixion. That there is no despair so deep or evil so overwhelming or place so far removed from joy, light, and love, so far removed from the very heart of God, that God has not been before us. And where he cannot meet us and bring us home.
Lord Jesus, you gave your life for us. You suffered and died that we might be made whole.
Reading from the Gospel of John, chapter 19, verse 28. After this, when Jesus knew that all was now finished, he said, in order to fulfill the scripture, "I thirst." There's a kind of timelessness about hanging on a cross. It is not a quiet death, over in an instant in one glorious moment of martyrdom, like being torn apart by lions. A cross is as much an instrument of torture as it is a gallows from which to hang. And as the day wears on, seconds stretch into minutes, which stretch into hours, until there comes a point when time can no longer be measured except in the gradual weakening of the body and its ever more insistent demands for that substance which is so vital to life, so foundational to all living things, so basic to existence as we know it, water. Water to moisten a parched mouth, water to free a swollen tongue, water to open a rasping throat that cannot gasp enough air, water to keep hope alive, to keep life alive just a few moments longer. Water to a crucified man is life. O God, you are my God. Earnestly I seek you. My soul thirsts for you. My flesh faints for you, as in a dry and weary land where there is no water. Who can tell if this prayer of David went through Jesus' mind in that moment? But a thirst for water is a thirst for life, and a thirst for life is a thirst for God, who promises streams in the desert, mighty rivers in the dry land, and living water to satisfy every thirst. But here, at the end of it all, those promises seem so far away. And yet Jesus, forsaken by God with the weight of our sin, still clings to the memory and the hope of life. I thirst.
Lord Jesus, you gave your life for us. You suffered and died that we might be made whole.
reading from the Gospel of John, 19th chapter, verses 29 and 30. A bowl was there, full of cheap wine mixed with vinegar. So a sponge was soaked in it, put on a stick of hyssop, and lifted to his lips. When Jesus had received the wine, he said, "It is finished." And he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. What a sigh of relief. What a cry of deliverance. That finally, after seemingly endless pain and gasping torment, it is almost over at last. When the suffering is ended, the ordeal complete, and nothing remains but the blessed peace of the absence of all sensation. When all there is pain, its ceasing is the greatest blessing of all, even when its ceasing comes only with death. But the cry of Jesus is more than just welcoming the end of pain. It is more than joy at the deliverance which death brings. He does not merely say it's over. He says it's accomplished, fulfilled, achieved. The cry of Jesus is not a cry of defeat and despair. It is a cry of success and triumph. Even at the moment of death, that the race has been run, that he has endured to the end, that the strife is over and the battle is won. The cry of Jesus is a cry of relief, to be sure, but it's also a cry of victory. The work I came to do is complete. There is nothing more to add. It is finished.
Lord Jesus, you gave your life for us. You suffered and died that we might be made whole.
It is the end, the very end, the end of the agony, the end of the suffering. A reading from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 23, verse 46. Then Jesus, crying with a loud voice, said, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." And having said this, he breathed his last. And Jesus, alone on the cross, tortured, exhausted, abandoned by his friends, forsaken by God, gasps for a last breath and gathers the strength for one final cry. Why would he choose to speak so close to the end? Why would he muster the last energy he had to cry with a loud voice? Couldn't God have heard his thoughts? Unless God wasn't the only one intended to hear. Unless his voice was pitched loud so that we too might hear this final dedication of his soul. A dedication made despite pain, despite the mocking, despite the affliction, despite the sense of overwhelming loneliness he felt. A dedication made to God before the resurrection, before the victory of the kingdom, before any assurance other than that which faith could bring. Jesus entrusts his spirit, his life and all that has given it meaning to God in faith, even at the point of his own abandonment, when the good seems so very far away. He proclaims his faith in God. And the darkness cannot and will not overcome it. Father, into your hands I commit my spirit.
Lord Jesus, you gave your life for us. You suffered and died that we might be made whole.
Would you join with me in a responsive reading of the word of God given through the prophet Isaiah as it comes to us from the book of Isaiah, chapter 53, verses 4 through 6 and verse 9. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. And he was bruised for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that made us whole. All we like sheep have gone astray. Each of us has turned to our own way. And the Lord has laid upon him the iniquity of us all. He was assigned a grave with the wicked and with the rich in his death. Although he had done no violence, nor was any deceit in his mouth.
feel the nail right now where you are. Don't let this moment pass you by. Without letting the weight that our Lord and Savior took upon himself, the weight of the sin of the world, feel this moment. Praise the one who paid my debt and your debt and raised our lives up from sin and death. Lord God, you have given us everything. You have not held anything back. Help us in like manner to give of ourselves. Sanctify us in Christ's name. Bless us and all that we think, feel, say, and do, that we, like Jesus, may be a blessing unto others. We ask this and all things that we ask of you through him, saying the prayer that he taught us.
Skin his knee, to crawl into the arms of his father, to nestle in the hollow of the neck of his mother. He knew what it was to grow, to hurt, to sweat, to bleed, to feel pain, to feel joy, to laugh,
to cry, to have friends, and to be the one left out. He was like you, and he was like me. For that was the way God intended it to be. And yet he wasn't like you, and he wasn't like me. For he walked in love, in every thought, word, and deed, and it allowed him to walk in truth that we can't even begin to fathom, much less accept in our own brokenness and our own sin. And the only human being that ever would have been justified in condemning any other did not. He took our sin, our suffering, our guilt, our shame, all the things that have turned creation against its creator, that word, that light that was the life of all men, and he took it into himself upon his own broken and bleeding body and said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. That light, which shone in the darkness then, it shines in the darkness now. And the darkness cannot comprehend it. It cannot understand it. It cannot overpower it, and nor shall it ever, ever extinguish it. We know 2,000 years on this side of the cross, we know that Sunday's coming. Tonight, my friends, stay at the foot of the cross. Let the weight of this night rest upon your heart and your soul. That the Holy Spirit might do his work upon you and within you and upon me and within me and change us. That we may see him as he is and see ourselves as we are, not only apart from him, but in him, that we might walk in the light as he is in and is the light. So tonight, as the Christ candle representing the light of the world as it exits out the center aisle, our readers will exit behind it. And then we invite you to leave this place in meditative silence. And tomorrow and all Holy Saturday may entail for you, let your heart continue to meditate upon what it must have been for those first followers of Christ. In all the uncertainty and the fear and the anxiety and the doubt and not knowing what this meant on that day after the cross. Let your heart be in that place tomorrow, my friends. For I promise you, if you do, God will meet you there. And we shall return to this space on Sunday. And we all know what that celebration means. And may God make it more glorious this year for us than ever before. But for now, the light still shines. The light of the one who would enter into death. The one who would go where every one of us must go as well, so that none of us might ever say, the Lord doesn't know. How can Jesus ever relate to what I am experiencing? This is how. Praise God. Praise be to the one who through death defeated death, and by his overwhelming, reckless love has proven how he is the way, the truth, and the life once and for all. Thanks be to God.